All right, the next thing that we want to learn is dropout regularization. And it's kind of still reminds me of the L1 regularization, because if you remember, it also makes some of the neurons inactive in a way. But here we are taking a very straightforward approach, and we say in every training step, every neuron has a possibility P of being inactive. So then you call this the dropout rate, P. So, you know, if out of one, you say every neuron has 0.25 chances of being inactive, then you might have a lot of neurons, like 1/4 of your neurons being inactive in your network. So let's go over how this works in the training. So let's say we have this nice little network. We say our dropout rate is 0.25. So every neuron has 1/4 chance of being inactive. During training time, of course, then you're going to get some of the neurons being inactive, right? Like in the first layer, in the first hidden layer, we have one guy missing here, we have another guy missing here. Of course, this is going to change which one is inactive, which one is active. But of course, this doesn't mean that for sure you're going to miss 1/4 of your neurons. It might also be that, you know, you only miss one neuron, or that you miss none. So it's basically on average, you're going to miss 1/4 of your neurons, but you might not always, of course. Or you might miss more than 1/4 of your neurons. So this is kind of just a probability, and we're going to run a kind of random generator and see which ones are going to be inactive. And this works actually pretty well, and dropout regularization actually, when you include it in your network, is shown to just increase the accuracy and decrease the loss significantly. So people are just kind of like using it either way, just putting it in there and see if it helps them increase their accuracy or generally performance. Okay, so this was the training time. In the training time, we are missing some neurons. They might be inactive, but in the test time, of course, we want all the neurons to be there. So there is a little trick here in how that works. We have another thing with dropout regularization, and that's called key probability. And that's just 1 minus the dropout probability, dropout rate. So during test time, we have the whole network, and the key probability here, because our dropout rate was 0.25, our key probability is 0.75. So what we need to do is basically, when we are calculating the input that goes into this guy, we're going to have to multiply our input with the key probability. So you might be like, but why? So let's see. So while we're training, what happens is, let's say in this network, in this hidden layer, the first hidden layer, as I said, we have 0.25 chances for each of these neurons to be inactive, right? So what's going to happen is that this guy will be missing in one, this guy will be missing another one, this guy will be missing in another one. So on average, we would expect this neuron to always accept or get inputs from 3 different neurons from the previous layer, because one of them is always going to be missing on average. Sometimes 2 of them will be missing, sometimes none of them will be missing. But on average, we will get 3 inputs. And how we can show that is that we'll have some weight times some input, some weight times some input, some weight times some input. But then on test time, because we have the whole network intact, no one is inactive, we will get 4 inputs. So we'll some weight, some input, some weight, some input, some weight, some input, etc. So we're getting inputs from all of them. But if you do that, you're going to get very different results, because you were getting on average 3 inputs and now you're getting 4 inputs. So that's why what you need to do is, when you are calculating this value, you just need to multiply it with the key probability, which will give you a scaled version of the output, of the input that you're getting. So it will basically, we were getting 3 things, let's say like 3 little balls. Now we're getting 4. If we multiply it by 0.75, it's going to be 3 balls again, in a way. This is very simplistic, but it works. And with Keras, how we do it, it's basically you just need to add some dropout layers in between. Keras does it for you. It takes a little bit of a different approach. And what it does is, instead of doing this extra calculation in the test time, it already divides the inputs by the key probability at training time. So what that means is when you divide it by 0.75, it actually would mean times 4 minus 3 divided by 3, right? So at the end, you're going to get something very similar. If you want, you can actually write this down. It really helped me to understand what was going on here, to just get a very simple ratio. You can use 0.25, you can use 0.5 to see that, oh, okay, yeah, that makes sense. This is a little bit different than multiplying the input with the key probability, but it gives more or less the same thing and they both work equivalently.